Plants and animals are easy to tell apart. This is a plant, this is an animal, but this is both. Hey animals and nearby listening plants, Trace here for DNews. Thanks for tuning in. If you look back to middle school science, you might remember kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. Easy to remember because kids playing chicken on freeways get smashed. Kingdom has five groups: Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae, and Animalia. But it was invented by humans, so sometimes there are exceptions to all of the rules. To be a plant, an organism has to make its own food and it has to have cell walls. To be an animal, you have to acquire nutrients by ingestion and you don't have cell walls. There's a lot more to it. That's the basic distinction. This goes even deeper. As biologists have looked into the genes that make up the DNA of our planet's organisms, classification has gotten, let's just say, fuzzy. In this case, two studies published in the journal Genome Research describe the way microRNA affects plants and animals differently. Animals, like humans, have microRNA which float around the cell nucleus, activating and deactivating genes. It's a little technical on how it does this, but in essence, animal microRNA affects how DNA and RNA express your genes. This helps organisms adapt to changing diets, environmental stimuli, and so on. Though, while animal microRNA affects lots of different gene expressions, plant RNA is much more specific. The sea anemone is classified as an animal because its DNA is similar to a vertebrate. It gathers food and does not have a cell wall, but its microRNA behaves as if it's a plant. Go home, nature. You're drunk. This isn't the only plantimal out there that gives the biologists a nerdgasm. Plantimal. It's a thing. Take note. A 2007 study from the University of Kalmar in Sweden found some species of algae which were plantimals. They dubbed them mixotrophs because they can produce energy from sunlight, like a plant, but they eat other things, like an animal. Another is the mesodinium chamaeleon, which sounds like a fancy lizard, but it's actually a single-celled organism. It eats other things, so animal, but it can use the things it's eaten and live off their photosynthesis while it's inside the body until the prey is digested, of course. Presumably, that's why it's called a chameleon, because, you know, depending on whether it's eaten red or green algae, it's gonna change color. The process of eating something and using it evolved 2 billion years ago. It's called endosymbiosis. When the first single-celled animals ate bacterium, the prey cell became part of the predator cell. This is how we got mitochondria. Many single-celled organisms flirt with that animal-plant boundary line depending on their needs and adaptations. Biologists are total frenemies with them. The sea anemone is significant because it's multicellular, and the gene regulation is similar to that of a fruit fly, which means there's likely a common link between human, fly, and sea anemone 600 million years ago. I think maybe plants and animals might be part of this thinner line. What do you think? Like, you know, fruits and vegetables, they're not that different. What do you think, though? Put your thoughts down below and subscribe. Thanks for watching DNews today, everybody.